Artificial intelligence, AI, is changing the rules affecting nearly every aspect of our lives. As you've probably heard, it's a powerful tool. So powerful, it's causing a new arms race of sorts, an arms race with consequences that are nothing less than life and death. Here's senior contributor Ted Koppel.
We are on the verge, really, of a new era.
Earlier this year, House and Senate committees and subcommittees heard a good bit of alarming testimony about
government cannot govern AI if it does not understand AI.
There are so many questions.
Artificial intelligence and China.
We're in direct competition with China. We win or they win.
The Chinese Communist Party deeply understands the potential for AI to disrupt warfare. AI is China's Apollo project.
The Chinese have something called civil-military fusion, which basically says the government can demand the cooperation of any company, any academic institution, any scientist in support of its military.
That's Michelle Flournoy, Undersecretary of Defense in the Obama administration.
We have a very different approach. We have a truly private sector, and individuals and scientists and academics and companies get to choose whether they want to contribute to national security.
Which may be as good a place as any to slow down for a moment. Because if we're going to understand the future of artificial intelligence in national security, it may help to take a look back.
Garry Kasparov has arrived.
To when AI was proving its potential on a couple of board games. In 1997, Garry Kasparov, widely regarded as one of the greatest chess masters of all time, accepted a challenge from IBM's Deep Blue. He won that first game, but that was it.
Kasparov is doing some very strange things right now.
He almost seems to be talking to himself.
Whoa! Kasparov has resigned.
On one level, Kasparov must have seen it coming.
He looks like a guy who's facing his own executioners.
The ancient game of Go is hugely popular in Asia, even more complicated than chess. This young South Korean Lee Sedol was considered perhaps the greatest Go player in the world. The award-winning documentary Alpha Go captured the media frenzy in 2016 before the first of five challenge matches between Lee Sedol and a specially designed AI program.
아무래도 역시 아직은 인간의 직관력이나 이런 감각들을
Lee Sedol and human intuition were crushed 4-1.
Lee Sedol just slapped himself on the side of the head.
But what was a staggering headline-making event only a few years ago is already little more than a footnote in the evolution of artificial intelligence. Which left poker. Heads up, no limit, Texas Hold'em. People get to lie in poker. Decisions have to be made on imperfect information, which is precisely what attracted the attention of Thomas Sandholm, a professor of computer science at Carnegie Mellon.
Almost all problems in the real world are imperfect information games, in the sense that the other players know things that I don't know, and I know things that the other players don't know.
In 2017, the team at Carnegie Mellon issued a challenge to four professional poker players, including Jason Less.
We really wanted to fight for humanity and show that our beloved game of poker was so complex that humans still had an edge over AIs.
Does AI play like a human?
It played very much unlike a human. An AI can know that it's going to play a certain hand 13% of the time and have a much more complex strategy than a human mind is able to have.
But you were representing humanity and you lost.
Rubbing salt in the wound, I had forgotten by now. But for us, like, yes, we wanted to demonstrate that this game was so complex that AI had not quite gotten there yet. Losing to that AI made me realize that this technology had gotten very advanced.
The techniques that we developed were not really techniques for solving poker per se. They were techniques for solving imperfect information games more generally.
Basically, poker is a civilized, relatively civilized form of warfare.
That is a good way to put it. We're not out there with guns, tanks, and planes, but we're out there with chips and cards, and we're waging battle there. It's still, at the end of the day, a strategy game.
Having sharpened their skills on poker, Professor Sandholm's AI company, Strategy Robot,
the behaviors are playing out exactly how we would expect,
now work as Pentagon contractors, filling in the gaps of imperfect information.
We're trying to help the nation and our allies have a superior AI capability for this type of decision making.
So I'm assuming that that kind of information is being funneled to the Ukrainian military.
I can't comment on that.
Okay. But whatever you have, you give to the Pentagon. What the Pentagon does
right.
with it is none of your business.
Well, it is our business. I just can't talk about it.
Okay. But is it fair to say that some of the same principles that are applied to AI playing poker are now being applied to a war that is being fought?
To the current war, I can't comment, but for military strategy, operations, and tactics in general, yes.
Yes. AI in warfighting is already a foregone conclusion. For the moment, though, U.S. policy insists that there always be human oversight. Artificial intelligence.
Yeah.
It's all we hear about, read about, see. Overhyped?
Yes and no.
And there's a new office at the Pentagon under the cautious guidance of Dr. Craig Martell to ensure that the policy is implemented.
My office, the Chief Digital and AI Office, has a pretty unique role. What we're going to do is provide guardrails and policies that say, if you're going to acquire AI, here's what it's like to do it responsibly. If you're going to deploy AI, here's how you have to evaluate it.
What that boils down to is a question of confidence when the wrong decision will cost lives.
So imagine an AI told a commander, do action A, and that the commander through all his or her training would have said do action B. What should that commander do? Should the commander listen to that machine, or should the commander listen to his or her training and her intuition?
Excellent question. What's your answer?
If the DoD is good at one thing, we are very good at training. Training, 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 training. And through all of that training, if the commander got used to trusting that machine, then the commander might trust that machine. If the commander got used to not trusting the machine, then the commander wouldn't.
If that sounds like a gigantic waffle, it is, but it also has the additional virtue of containing more than a grain of truth. Jason Less, the dethroned poker champion, speaks from personal experience.
I can take you back to the beginning of this AI challenge. AI told me how to play a hand a certain way. I would have believed from my experience, from what the AI was telling me, that this is not good advice, and my conventional wisdom and my understanding of strategy was the most optimal. However, over time, playing against the AI for thousands of hands, finally that confidence builds up, and eventually it's trusted for these higher stakes decisions.
The thing that keeps me up at night is really, what if in these military settings we fall behind, for example, China, in our decision-making AI technology?
Do you think that's happening?
I think China has caught up in AI with the US overall, and we're kind of on par right now. I think in military AI, China has much better pickup in actually adopting AI in the military.
I don't think we know exactly how fast they're moving.
That's former Undersecretary of Defense Michelle Flournoy.
I think we cannot afford to take our foot off the gas. When you think about, you know, a China scenario, if China's moving against Taiwan, if you wait until they're actually attacking Taiwan to have that sense of urgency and to respond, it's going to be over before the first new piece of whatever you think you need actually arrives. So to me, that means that we haven't fully absorbed the urgency of doing this.
Which is precisely what makes this next statement, and it does accurately reflect U.S. policy, difficult to accept.
So we have got to proceed with development, but with a very strong ethical and normative framework in place that ensures that the only AI we actually deploy for military purposes is safe, is secure, is responsible, is explainable, is trustworthy. But this notion that AI is going to be making large campaign-level decisions in warfare, I don't see that given our values as a democracy, given the norms that we've established already.
And yet, when we come up against the competition and we come to believe that our competitors are not being bound by the same ethical guidelines, what do you do?
If an adversary uses a weapon for, you know, that creates massive civilian casualties or things that are equivalent to war crimes, we don't say, okay, well, we have to do that too. We call them out on it and we try to sanction them.
I'm not sure I accept that. There have simply been too many times, going back to 1945 and the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, when we clearly were not bound by those kinds of strictures.
That's fair.
And when we feel that an adversary is gaining advantages over us, I'm not altogether confident that we would remain bound by those kind of strictures.
Yeah, my hope would be that we wouldn't abandon the same principles that as they did. Because at the end of the day, how we fight says a lot about who we are.
Precisely the argument made last summer when the Biden administration sent a shipment of cluster bombs, banned by more than 120 countries, to Ukraine.
Cluster munitions, why now?
We've run out of ammunition.
Running out of ammunition.
The issue before us, though, is human oversight of all military AI programs.
The mistakes that I see in life, almost all of them are made by humans.
That's Professor Thomas Sandholm again.
People think that, you know, there should be human oversight of AI, which I actually do believe. There should be human oversight of AI, but there should also be AI oversight of humans. So the oversight should be both directions, and that balance of oversight is going to shift over time.
There is, when you think about it, a pattern that different artificial intelligence programs established in the games they won over the very best players in the world, in poker, in Go, and in chess. Hardly anyone believed that it could happen, until, of course, it did.
That's right. Humans believe that they're better at decision-making than they really are.